I said that I was going to do some closing remarks, and has James showed up? Yeah, he did, but I didn't want to see. I would like to introduce James, but I guess that's one thing that's changed, you know, it's changed forever. Being a single parent with a 14, 15, 16-year-old is a challenge. But, you know, I have remarks here that I could read, and really I have waited a long time for, you know, many months since she passed away, and try to get over the pain of, you know, just the change in our lives. And I feel very fortunate to have spent 25 years with someone who is such an intellectual dynamo. I mean, one of my most common things I would say to her, I said, look at Melinda, I am not Saul Bellow. Please, I'm Joe from South Dakota. I can only go so far. But that intensity and that pushing, you know, was just tremendous. And I think that, you know, the work ethic and her output is just phenomenal. And, you know, I'm so proud and impressed with her and the fact that one of our friends who was, again, stopped by the volcano, Heather Norman, who went to school with her, said, you know, Joe, I've been telling my friends that I think of Melinda every day, and almost something about Melinda every day. And when I do, I stop and I say, you know, I have to aim higher. I can do better every day. And Melinda just had that energy that is really good for everyone. And I think I want to end on this painting over here. And obviously the night she died, and James wasn't at home, and Robert was over at Oxford, and I was all up all night on trying to figure out how to get Robert on a plane and home, and he had just started exam courses, and if he could only be back for a day. I wrote this, and I read it in Sag Harbor, and many of the family members who are here, my cousins, my brothers, nieces, nephews, and my mom's sister, always talked about Melinda. She was a Franciscan nun. She is a Franciscan nun, taught for 30 years in the Minnesota school system, became a hospice worker in the slums of Chicago. And she called, and I spoke to her for a long time, and she said, well, you know, Joe, I look at Melinda's paintings, I read her poetry, and Melinda is more than religious, and she's more than spiritual. You know, she's actually mystical. She sort of has a sense of where humanity was, is going. And so when I wrote it, I look at this painting Melinda did in 1992, you know, sort of like, I guess that one there also, the Melinda Lane in State at her funeral. She knew to paint it. She had this feeling, whether she's here or not. And I just want to go over this painting from sort of my perspective. And I never actually said these words to Melinda at the time, although we talked about it in various ways. I don't know if this was her last meal. But I look at this figure on the adobe wall of a woman sort of being crucified. And in my mind, Melinda knew 15 years ago that she was going to suffer great pain. She knew it, and she just knew it. She also knew something else about human nature that we face, we don't face. Most of us are not honest enough to say these types of things. But she knew at some point that her soul, her spirit was going to leave her body. She knew that she would have to separate from this world and leave her physical self, and that she knew that she must take a new path to heaven. And so she knew in 1992, long before she got cancer and everything like that, and I guess that's what I was always struck by with her. You know, I just learned every day, and she's taking her walk to the new worlds. And so I really thank you all for coming. There are plays, interviews, novels, you know, art, poetry books there. Please take them, read the ones you want, pass them on, and please have a glass of wine and enjoy yourself. And I thank you for coming. And I know I want everyone to meet everyone, and that's, I made name tags. But Joyce Berry made name tags for me. So thank you very much, everybody.